Good evening. My thanks to the organizers of this event for giving me the chance to take part. If you've had a chance to look at my bio, and if you did look at it, you'd probably notice that I might be described as an actor turned diplomat. And because of that, you might guess that creativity is one of my favorite subjects to talk about. No matter where I've worked, people have asked me about creativity in the United States and how it developed. And tonight I'm going to share with you some of my personal views of how America's creative culture developed and some of the historical and cultural factors that have influenced it and the choices that America has made over the course of its history that have really helped us to become one of the world's creative centers. I'd like to start with talking a little bit about the title I chose for my remarks, in particular this word, local. In my remarks, I'll be using the word local in a very broad sense. In the United States, local might mean your state, city or county government. It might also mean a private company or a not-for-profit non-governmental organization. It might even mean yourself, the individual. Now, I focus on this word local because, in my opinion, it's precisely these kinds of entities, private companies, state and local governments, that are the real drivers of America's creative culture. Now, I'd like to start with some history. Even before there was a country called the United States, creativity thrived in North America. Native American peoples who lived in the area now known as the United States created their own amazing artistic traditions of ceramics, music, and other art forms. Some of these creative traditions still persist in the United States and have given rise to some of our most important creative centers, particularly those located in the Southwest. But if you wanted to pinpoint the birth of U.S. creativity, I think you'd need look no further than America's founding fathers themselves. Now, I know that people like George Washington or Alexander Hamilton or Thomas Jefferson might not be the first names that come to mind when you think of the beacons of world creativity, but I actually think they should be. I mean, after all, the country that they helped found and the system of government that they designed for it, one that ensured that all men are created equal and entitled to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, was really unprecedented. The United States has been called the Great Experiment, and I think like any experiment, it really required the spark of creativity to take place. Now, by infusing traditional theories of representative democracy with a uniquely American spirit, our founding fathers were revolutionaries and innovators whose courage and leadership gave birth to a new country that's now more than 230 years old. But I should note that one of America's founding fathers, Benjamin Franklin, was a bona fide creative genius, no matter what your definition is. Franklin was a statesman, a scientist, an inventor, and a writer, and his genius is really unmatched during his time or any other. And I also remember that Franklin was the author of a useful saying about talking too much. He said, "He that speaks much is much mistaken," which I think is important for me to remember as I continue my remarks. The system of government that our founding fathers designed for the United States, a federalist democracy, is another source of our creative culture and one of the reasons for my thesis that American creativity starts local. Now, this system of government, federalism, gives primary political power to our 50 states and local governments and actually places important checks on the power of the federal government. Federalism, for example, is one of the reasons why the United States, unlike many other countries, has no Ministry of Culture. I mean, in the arts in particular, we like to keep our creativity local with minimal interference from the federal government. Now, federalism has a wide range of impacts on American life. It is one of the reasons, for example, that our educational system, what some people might call the incubator of our future creative geniuses, is really left to state and local governments to regulate. Now, this system is the subject of debate, even in the United States, and many people are quick to point out the challenges that our public schools face. But I think that limited view actually neglects
the power of America's approach to education. For example, our educational system has given rise to innovative public schools like the National Inventors Hall of Fame School in Akron, Ohio, which encourages young learners to use their creativity every day. For example, when those students at that school found a way to make their library quieter. Now, wherever you go in the United States, you'll find creative local examples of education such as that, be they in public schools, private schools, religious schools, or charter schools, which are sort of a combination of public and private. Our universities are another one of our most important sources of creativity and innovation. The flexibility and the variety of choices that U.S. universities offer allows students to experiment in countless ways, which later fuels their creativity. I myself am a very proud example of the American tradition of the liberal arts. Just to give you an example, as an undergraduate, I studied a wide range of courses from theater to languages, to literature, to social sciences, also things like psychology. And I really think that that varied academic background has given me the tools I've needed to have a fulfilling personal and professional life. And I hope even to bring a little bit of creativity into my daily work. Now, if you want to learn a little bit more about America and creativity, you might want to think about studying what are known as America's creative cities. There are theorists such as Richard Florida who've examined why certain parts of the United States, such as San Francisco and the nearby Silicon Valley, have become real hotbeds of American creativity. I mean, after all, this is the part of our country that has produced such creative leaders as Mark Zuckerberg, the founder of Facebook, and of course, Steve Jobs, the late founder of Apple. Now, in the United States, as I said, we don't have a Ministry of Culture, which means that state and local governments are given completely free rein to take steps to encourage creativity and to encourage creative people to move to their cities. This can take many forms. For example, cities might give tax incentives to encourage people to start new businesses. They might nurture local arts communities. They might even, as in the case of San Francisco, provide a welcoming atmosphere for America's gay community, which is one source that Mr. Florida cites as an important source of our creativity. Now, if you're interested in studying America's creative cities, two cities you might take a look at are Santa Fe, New Mexico, and Iowa City, Iowa. Both of these cities are included in UNESCO's network of creative cities. And I think both of these cities are important because in both cases, they capitalized on local creative movements that had begun quite organically in their environs. In the case of Santa Fe, it was the local arts and crafts culture and the work of such local artists as Georgia O'Keeffe that enabled that city to become a creative center. And in addition, that city had a really strong Native American and later Spanish influence that it really turned it into what it is today. In the case of Iowa City, it was the Iowa Writers' Workshop and the creative writing program at the University of Iowa, which every year attracts some of the world's leading authors and intellectuals. Now, wherever you go in America, you will find local creative success stories like this. Be they local film festivals, theater festivals, scientific conventions. These types of events not only fuel particular cities' creativity, they also help those cities' economies as well. Now, another product of America's federalist system has been an abiding belief in the United States in the rule of law. And it's this system, this rule of law, that really underscores our important laws that protect intellectual property rights. These are the laws that ensure that creative works or new medicines or new inventions are all protected by law. Now, you see the power of these types of IPR laws very early in America's history, when the creations of such people as Alexander Graham Bell, the inventor of the telephone, and Thomas Edison, the inventor of the modern light bulb, were all protected by patents. Edison himself was the owner of an amazing 1,093 patents. Later inventors, such as the inventors of the world's first successful airplane, the Wright brothers, the inventor of the polio vaccine, Jonas Salk, and the automotive pioneer and developer of the moving assembly line, Henry Ford, were all protected by patents. Now, there are many reasons why protecting intellectual property is important, but I think the relationship between intellectual property rights and creativity is actually quite simple. If you don't give creative people the power to control their inventions and to benefit from them financially, eventually they'll stop doing what they do best, which is to create. And I think lastly, as we talk about IPR, we all know that it is through IPR that we've enabled the United States to produce what might be its most identifiable cultural export, which is our entertainment business. But it's not just Hollywood movies that benefit from IPR. Not only in the United States, but all over the world, such local traditions as local cultural traditional dance in Korea, even, I've heard, Parmesan cheese in Italy, are all protected by intellectual property rights. Now, I just want to say one word about Hong Kong, and I think one thing that I think is positive is that Hong Kong shares America's fundamental commitment to intellectual property rights. Hong Kong has strong IPR laws, an effective enforcement capacity, a judicial system that supports enforcement, and public education campaigns that discourage people from engaging in IPR infringing activities. Now, no matter where you go, I think an important source, and probably the most visible source, of a country's creative cultural industry is its artistic traditions. And the United States has no shortage of artistic treasures, from the paintings of Edward Hopper to the music of George Gershwin. And we have world-renowned opera companies, a theater scene that goes from big-budget Broadway shows to off-Broadway, off-beat productions such as this one. Now, the United States is not alone in having a strong artistic tradition, but I think one thing that does distinguish us is how we pay for and support this tradition. Now, I said before that the United States has no central ministry of culture. The largest federal government-provided source of grants to artists is called the National Endowment for the Arts, and it has a budget of about $150 million. However, the contribution of the private sector to the arts in the United States is estimated to be at $12 billion. So you've got $150 million from the federal government and about $12 billion from the private sector. In fact, the federal government only gives about 2% of funding for the arts. State and local governments provide about 8%. But that means that 90% of funding for the arts in the United States comes from private corporations, philanthropic organizations, or even from individual Americans. Just to give you an example, when she died in 2003, Joan Kroc, who was the widow of the founder of McDonald's, left $200 million to our national public radio. So I think that's important that when we look at big companies like McDonald's, in many cases, those are the types of corporations that are supporting our creative culture. Now, as I begin to reach the end of my presentation time, I just want to touch on a few important values that the United States has that I think have fueled our creativity. The first is ethnic diversity, which I think is amply reflected in our roster of creative geniuses. African Americans have overcome the legacy of slavery and centuries of discrimination to really emerge as one of the driving forces of American creativity. Around the turn of the 20th century, the African American community was the birthplace of that distinctly American genre of music, jazz. And later, the Harlem Renaissance of the 1920s and 30s brought an explosion of creativity in terms of art, literature, music, and ideas. Creative African Americans such as the inventor George Washington Carver, the musician Duke Ellington, and the singer Ella Fitzgerald all triumphed despite the challenges that they faced. Now, this rich tradition of African American creativity is continued today with such figures as the media mogul Oprah Winfrey, who I read is considered the world's first black female billionaire. Also, people like Nobel Prize-winning author Toni Morrison, and one of my favorites, the rap, hip-hop musician and entrepreneur Jay-Z. Now, also tied to our ethnic diversity, America's history of immigration and our status as the world's melting pot has had an extraordinary impact on our creative culture. And when you look at the roster of the world's creative geniuses, it's really amazing how many of them ended up immigrating to the United States. Just to give you some examples, people like the physicists Albert Einstein and Enrico Fermi, the artist Joseph Stella, and the architect I.M. Pei all brought their talents to the United States and used the United States as a creative platform to broaden their impact. Now, since we're in Hong Kong, I thought I would mention a few connections between the United States and Hong Kong in the area of creativity. Now, these connections go back a long way, and they've been fueled in part by immigration and in part by the history of cultural and educational exchange that's existed between us for a long time. Hong Kong has historically been one of the top sources of students to the United States from foreign places, and today still ranks at number 16 with about 8,000 students from Hong Kong currently studying in the United States. Because I can give you one example of, I think, a very good example of the power of U.S. education, is the founder of the City Contemporary Dance Company, Willie Tsao, who studied in the United States, and he's now known as the father of contemporary dance in China. Other people, like the designer Gang Dai-gung and Freeman Lau, both the latter of whom is the designer of the iconic Watson's water bottle, both actually participated in exchange programs supported by the U.S. consulate. One more example you might be interested to know is that the famed author Eileen Zhang, who wrote Lust, Caution, and other works, actually worked here at the U.S. consulate for 3 years before she went to the United States. Now, I just want to leave you, as I reach the end of my remarks, with a question. Now, to me, there are many, many examples as to why, or reasons why creativity matters, from cultural reasons to social reasons, from economic reasons to even spiritual ones. But I think the key is that creativity matters, no matter if you're in the United States or right here in Hong Kong. Thank you very much.